Hello and welcome to this Neuromatch Academy lecture on synaptic transmission. My name is Richard Node, I'm from the University of Ottawa, and today I want to talk about the question of when one neuron is connected to another neuron through a synapse, how does the firing of the first neuron influencing the state of the other neuron? And in particular, I want to know what statistical property of the presynaptic neuron ensemble is communicated to the postsynaptic neuron. So first, a little bit of anatomy. There's two sides of the synapse. There's a presynaptic side where an action potential arrives and triggers synaptic release through vesicles fusing on the membrane. Then there's the postsynaptic side, which has receptors sensing the presence of these neurotransmitters and opening ion channels, leading to current flow. Broadly speaking, there are two types of synapses, and these synapses have a fast and a slow component. There are glutamatergic synapses, who use neurotransmitter glutamate, and there are GABAergic synapses, who use neurotransmitter GABA. The glutamatergic synapses create excitatory effect on the postsynaptic cell. And there are two components to it, a fast one, which is called AMPA, and a slower one, which is called NMDA. Similarly, the GABAergic synapses are causing an inhibitory effect on the postsynaptic membrane. The fast component is called GABA-A, and the slow component is called GABA-B. Synaptic currents are all due to conductance changes. What does that mean? It means that to get to a current, a change in conductance, which means that the ion channels are opening, changing the conductance of the membrane. But that doesn't mean that there's current flowing through, because it could be that the ions that can't cross this particular ion channel do not want to cross. Whether they want to cross or not depends on the relative concentration of those ions on the both sides of the membrane. And this is put in equation by this distance between the membrane potential and a reversal potential that is specific to the synapse being either glutamatergic or GABAergic. And in this way, by multiplying the change in conductance and the time-dependent distance between the membrane potential and its reversal potential, we get to the current that's flowing through the synapse. The same holds for all other synapses, with the exception that NMDA receptors have their conductance change that is not purely time-dependent and triggered by the release of receptors, but also depend on the membrane potential of the postsynaptic cell. Typically, we say that a change in conductance is a stereotypical time-dependent function that follows an exponential decay. For the AMPA component, the rise time being so fast, we typically assume that it's an instantaneous jump followed by a very quick decay. For all other synaptic kinds, we have a bi-exponential function that will describe the rise and the decay of the conductance. Now, let me stress the difference between conductance changes and current changes and potential changes, again with that slide. If the cell is at the resting potential, meaning that V is far from the reversal potential EE, the excitatory postsynaptic conductance will be triggered by the presynaptic spike, increase, and decay with an exponential. The current that is associated with this change of conductance will have exactly the same shape. And the potential might be a smoothed version of this because of the effect of the capacitor and the resistance of the cell membrane and converting current to membrane potential. Now, if instead we are at the reversal potential, meaning that V is equal to E, this factor is zero. The membrane potential is such that the ions do not want to cross the cell membrane, even if the ion channels are opening. This is what's happening here. The conductance is changing, but it leads to no current passing through and no detectable change in potential. That's what we call shunting. It's the shunting effect of conductance-based synapses. Now, because the reversal potential of excitatory synapses is very far above the threshold, the conductance is typically proportional to the current, and we don't really need to think about this effect. For inhibitory synapses, however, GABAergic synapses, this is not the case, and a shunting effect is often observed. Now, let's consider what happens when we have multiple neurons connected to one postsynaptic neuron. One neuron is firing a spike at a certain time, which creates an excitatory postsynaptic potential of a stereotypical shape that I called here epsilon 1. That is a time-dependent function that is triggered at the firing time TF. The same neuron can be emitting multiple action potentials, meaning that really to describe the whole postsynaptic membrane potential, I need to sum over all the different firing times of that one neuron. Simple. Now, adding the other neurons, I also have to sum the effect of all these neurons, meaning that to capture those postsynaptic potentials, I also need to sum over not only the firings of each individual neurons, but all the neurons together. There are two sums. The peri-stimulus time histogram, or ensemble rate, is the relative number of spikes within a certain time window. Let me consider this raster plot again, where each line corresponds to an independent neuron, and each tick along a line is a spike for that particular neuron. I can be interested in knowing at each moment of time the relative proportion of neurons that were active within a small smoothing window that I called epsilon. To do this, I replace every tick by a smoothing window at that particular time. I sum them across all the neurons, and then divide by the number of neurons and the size of that smoothing window, and I get ensemble rate, the fraction of neurons that are firing at that particular time. The ensemble rate equation is almost exactly the same as the postsynaptic membrane potential that we would get from an ensemble of cells connected to it, meaning that synapses are communicating the ensemble rate of the presynaptic population. But wait a second, is that true? If that were true, it would mean that I can interchange the order of the sum, meaning that I could take those spikes from the other neurons and make them fired from the first neuron. If that's really how synaptic communication works, there would be no change to the postsynaptic membrane potential. And those two scenarios would be completely equivalent. Well, there are many reasons why this is not the case, But the most important one is the presence of short-term dynamics at the synapses. So short-term dynamics means that as a function of the firing history, the amplitude of the postsynaptic currents or postsynaptic potential is changing. But it's changing in a transient manner, meaning that if you wait a long time, the amplitude will be the same as the one before. So while there are many reasons why this is not the case, one of the main reasons is the presence of short-term dynamics at the synapses. When a train of action potential is coming through an axon, some synapses will have the amplitude of the excitatory postsynaptic currents increasing. This change of amplitude as a function of the history of firing is called short-term dynamics. It's not considered to be a type of plasticity per se, at least not one that would contribute to learning and memory, mainly because if you wait not so long of a time, the amplitude will be the same as at the beginning, so the effect of the history is short-lived. There are some pathways in the brain that are making solely short-term facilitating synapses, meaning that there's an increase in the amplitude with recent firing. And other pathways are making short-term depressing synapses, meaning that the amplitude is decreasing with recent firing. These distinct dynamics can come from the same axons, but onto different postsynaptic targets. Now, synapses are super complicated, and there are many ways with which they can create short-term dynamics, and there are multiple kinds of short-term dynamics. But the main ones are described here. For facilitation, a firing can cause an increase in the release probability of the vesicles, meaning that when an isolated spike comes, the release probability is low, and maybe only one vesicle is releasing. Now, when another spike comes shortly after, the probability of releasing those vesicles has increased, meaning that all vesicles are releasing their content, releasing much more glutamate, and that creates a bigger effect on the postsynaptic side. For depressing synapses, one important mechanism is the change in the size of the readily releasable pool of vesicles. So, when one action potential comes, the release probability at those synapses being slightly higher, all vesicle might be releasing, which has depleted the releasable pool, meaning that when another action potential comes shortly after, there might be only one vesicle ready to be releasing, and other vesicles are not yet docked or ready to release their contents. So that means that there's much less glutamate or neurotransmitter being released, and you have a smaller effect on the postsynaptic side. The combination of this increase in release probability and this decrease in the size of the readily releasable pool of vesicles has been put into a mathematical model by Tsodyks and Markram. It's called the Tsodyks-Markram model. Now, this model uses two state variables to describe the amplitude of the postsynaptic currents, U and R. The multiplication of the two gives the amplitude. R is thought to be the size of the readily releasable pool. It follows linear dynamics on a time scale tau R, and whenever a presynaptic spike comes, it is reduced by U, which is the release probability at that time. And the release probability also evolves with linear dynamics and can also change whenever a presynaptic spike comes. It would normally increase by an amount that is controlled by the parameter F. And together, these two effects can create depression, facilitation, or a combination of both. And you can get these different phenotypes by changing the parameters, the timescales, and the amount of change that there is upon spiking. Here is an illustration for a facilitating synapse. The variable U describing the release probability, when the spike comes, is jumping up and with a fairly slow decay is able to accumulate such that the release probability is gradually increasing when a fast train of action potential is coming. On the other hand, if the depression variable tau r is fast, and so that the number of vesicles is recovering quickly, whenever the spike comes, there is time for this variable r to come back to almost its stationary value here of 1. So that really all we need to care about when we're looking at the efficacy, the amplitude on the postsynaptic side, being the multiplication of the two, is only U. And here is the efficacy as a function of the spikes, spike 1, spike 2, spike 3, spike 4, and you see this increase. What is important to note is that when we take the efficacy, we take U and R not after the jump, because this is caused by the spike coming, but just before the jump. Because just before the jump, the action potential comes, is reading the state of the release probability, and reading the amount of vesicles ready to be released, and then it creates release of neurotransmitter. Now this saturation here comes from the fact that U increases and we are jumping only proportional to U. This is typical of many recordings as well. Now let me come back to the question, can we shuffle the spikes across the population? Well, in the presence of, say, facilitating synapses, two spikes coming close together will not have the same postsynaptic effect, but instead, the second one will be much amplified. Well, that means that if I take those two spikes and I move them to be in this neuron, then this neuron has a higher frequency exactly at that time, meaning that the second spike will have to be amplified. So the difference between this red curve here and the black curve here is what changes when, instead of having all the spikes distributed among the population, you put all the spikes in the presynaptic population. So in the presence of short-term dynamics, you cannot shuffle the spikes from one neuron to the next because you need to preserve the particular structure of interspike intervals. Another conclusion from this is that synapses that are dynamic, that have this short-term dynamics, do not communicate the ensemble rate. They communicate something slightly different. So this is what I want to conclude from this lecture. Static synapses communicate the ensemble rate of all the presynaptic neurons. Dynamic synapses, synapses with short-term facilitation or short-term depression, are introducing a sensitivity to the single neuron interspike interval and are communicating something slightly different. If you want to know more about the subject, I've assembled here a list of textbooks and papers on the subject. So in the set of exercises, you will simulate static and dynamic synapses in response to different types of inputs.